Hi, I'm Martha Monroe from the University of Florida, and this is an introduction to environmental communication. So, you might think this should be easy, right? We communicate all the time. We're born communicating, so what's the problem? Well, communication is successful when people are interested, when the information is relevant and meaningful, when the message is communicated clearly, and when it's simple and straightforward and not at all controversial. And then you're right, it is easy and we are successful and that's the way it works. But we don't often have all of those situations present in our environment. So if people aren't interested, then we have ways and strategies to create interest, right? We can help ask questions and we can get them to ask questions so that we can point out the relevance between what we're saying and what they need to know. We can do a better job of linking our topic with their lives. We can work on the message to make sure that it is simple and that it provides clarity. And sometimes we can do an audience analysis to find out more about what they know, what they care about, and how to make our message meaningful. So those are all things that environmental communicators do so that they do a better job of effectively communicating environmental information. They care about audience perceptions and knowledge and attitudes. They find out who they trust and why they trust those kinds of people. They explore these factors with audiences to think about how to help predict which messages are going to be more effective. And they also think about who to distribute information to and what media channels to use to distribute that information. They might think about how to make something more visually appealing and graphic, using graphics, color and size, whether or not to tell one side of the story or two sides of the story, so that they can effectively communicate information to people appropriately and ultimately, perhaps, change behavior. All that's part of environmental communications. And some of this relates to other parts of this course. You could watch the video on social marketing or environmental conflicts and social learning strategies to find out more about information that's involved in environmental communications. So I think it's worth spending a couple minutes to look at some cases and conditions where we don't do a good job, where things are a little bit more complicated. And these are cases where we need to work harder to be successful. Part of working harder means listening. That means maybe it's a two-way conversation between us and our audience, but there's ways to do a better job of communicating. In these situations, the audience holds different ideas in their head than we do. It may be based on experience. They've had some sort of experience that tells them what's going to happen, and they don't believe what you're saying. There's information out there that they don't trust, they don't believe you, and they stop listening to you. They say, well, she's crazy, she doesn't know what she's talking about. That's a bad situation. You don't want to have that happen to you. It could also happen because they have partial information. There's some information they have, it's not the whole story, but it's enough to make them not want to believe you. It's also a case where it could be based on values and worldviews. So here's an example that's classic, often from physics and astronomy. We know from experience that the closer we are to something that is hot, the warmer we feel. Whether it's a stove or a fire, the closer we get, the warmer we feel. What we feel is based on distance. And as a result of that, some people believe that it's warmer in the summertime because we're closer to the sun. And it's that distance between the Earth and the Sun that makes all the difference in the world. Well, if you remember your astronomy, you know that's not really true. But because people have the experience of being closer to a heat source, they believe that it's the distance that makes the difference. And if a teacher says, oh no, that's really not true, they don't believe the teacher. And that's a problem with communication. So science educators call that science misconceptions. Sometimes people don't like that term and they call it prior knowledge or underlying conceptions or some other term, because actually sometimes maybe the people are right and the educator is wrong and we have to have more of a conversation to figure that out. But basically the idea is that there's something in their head that makes them not believe what you're saying, and it's an underlying scientific principle. So there's four key things you can do to overcome these prior conceptions. Number one, you can understand what people are thinking. You can ask them questions. You can find out what's going on in their head. And then you acknowledge the truth in their experience, because indeed, they are warmer when they get closer to a campfire or a stove. But then you want to point out evidence that makes that wrong, so that's information to the contrary, and then an idea that explains both their experience and that information to the contrary. For example, you might say, well, if distance is the only thing that's making it warmer in the summer than the winter, then it should be just as warm at night as it is in the day, because we haven't changed the distance to the sun. And they would say, well, no, it's cooler in the night. And you would say, well, why is that? Well, because the sun's not shining. And then you say, oh, so there's something about the sunshine itself that makes all the difference in the world, not the distance between the Earth and the sun. So now they're on a path to understand, okay, maybe there's something else out there. That's how we overcome scientific misconceptions. Media and special interests don't help with this process. They're more likely to sell papers by exacerbating conflict and by promoting partial truths. So they want people to only understand that their piece of the picture and not tell the whole story. I was in a situation where environmentalists were saying, oh, well, our landfills are filling up. We need to be recycling because we don't have enough places to put our garbage. And somebody from the plastics industry said, that's a lie. That's totally untrue. Partial information going on here. And so I said, well, tell me more about that. Why do you think our landfills aren't filling up? And they said, because there's plenty of room for landfills way out in the desert. Which is true. If we wanted to pay the money to haul our garbage way over there, we could bury it. So what the environmentalists are saying, the cheapest way for you to get rid of your garbage is to bury it right here, and our landfills are filling up. And what the industry is saying is, if you pay enough money, you can bury your garbage lots of places. And so they're all presenting a piece of the puzzle. They're not telling the whole truth. And that means environmental educators could get into a kind of sticky problem, because they're trying to help people understand that these special interests are only saying a part of what's true. Sometimes these conflicts are also due to worldview and different value positions. And that also makes it difficult to figure out how to communicate effectively and clearly, because our worldview affects what we hear, what we remember, who we trust, what we listen to. And so, environmental educators need skills of listening and facilitating these conversations, of working across boundaries and building partnerships between people, being open to new ideas and perspectives to be able to say, well, why do you think that? Why do you think that's true? And learning from people so that you can more effectively communicate. I think if we treat each opportunity to have a conversation as a challenge to understand what people think and how we can do a good job of communicating with them, then we're always exploring, we're always learning, we're respecting people on all sides of the fence and providing them opportunities to engage with each other and with us and learn more. And that's some of the things that environmental educators are doing. So you have these skills, you can do these things, you can share with each other some of the experiences you have, and you can put these ideas to practice. Thanks.